We'll see you next time. Good night. Thank you.
Most nights I come off stage and feel fine and like to, you know, meet people. I don't think I could just disappear and go back and, you know, sit in my hotel room. I find it very difficult going to sleep anyway after shows. I mean, I don't go to sleep before about 3 or so.
I have that same feeling, you know, you're charged for a bit, but shortly after that, what comes from me is a complete sort of drain. And the best I can do is pretty much sit in the shower. And I say sit because that's the important part. I'll start standing, but after about 5 minutes, I'm literally sitting in the corner. I'm discovering over the last couple of tours, and this one more so even than the last one, that I'm hitting a point where I can't do this for much longer. You know, I'm going to have to figure out something different.
Touring in general, doesn't matter if it's this size or smaller, is difficult, and you have to be a special type of person, and some musicians can't handle long spells on the road.
Yes.
How long has it been since you
15,
were...
15 years.
15 years?
14 years, sorry, 14.
What? 14 years.
Done.
What do you think of our humble mode of transportation here?
It was a 16-seater in 1994, and now, what would you say, 80 seats, 100 seats? So I think maybe the entourage has got bigger. The operation's very slick and... You're still listening.
I'm listening.
And the mood in the camp is very good, considering you had a shaky start and it's been 8 months in. Everyone's is acting like it's only sort of 1 or 2 months in.
Unraveling things and canceling shows is much more difficult than putting it together. But it's a reality and it's part of life. It's what we had to deal with and we dealt with it.
We haven't canceled many shows in our career. We're pretty sort of hardy fellows, you know. And we had no reason to think that we'd have problems on this tour.
We were hit with a couple of things at the beginning of this tour. All signs really were like, maybe this is not such a good idea right now.
Day before the Israeli show, my father died, which was obviously a big blow for me.
I mean, it's just a very strange situation for him to be in when for such tragic news to come through. So he dealt with it extremely well.
I think I still really respect the fact that he went on stage and played that night. You know, I think it's really difficult to do that.
I think when something like your father dies, there's almost a sense, especially if you're abroad somewhere, of sort of, did that happen? Did someone actually say that my father died? Or, do you know what I'm saying? You sort of don't believe it, really, although you know it's true.
There was definitely some discussions about, should we continue? You know, and this was before I kind of got, you know, diagnosis that, you know, I had cancer, you know, as well.
You know, I travelled from the hotel to the venue with Dave, who was happy, chatty, laughing. You know, we got to the venue, you know, like you said, the support band had gone on, all the pre-show music was playing, the audience were getting worked up into a frenzy.
That gig in Athens is really nice. It's got a great backstage area. We were just all hanging out. And then 20 minutes before we went on, Jonathan just came and said, I think we might have a problem.
He dragged me off and got Andy as well and took us off into a side room. And he just said, Dave's not feeling very well. You know, we're getting a doctor here now, but there is a chance that he might not be able to go on.
He was throwing up. He was pale. I mean, he was really upset. I mean, because the poor guy, I mean, the pressure on him, hearing, because we were literally right behind the stage, so we can hear the, and the Greek crowd are pretty passionate, so we could hear the chanting.
We had to do a runner out of there. We had to leave. So there's nothing worse than when you leave the gig and you still see people running to see the show, you know, parking their cars and everything. It's not nice.
That evening, I think the doctor saw something that he felt should get checked out properly. And at that point, Dave felt that he should go back to the States to have that checked out.
We still were totally in the dark. It was only after, you know, Dave went back to New York for more tests that, you know, we found out that it was a malignant tumour.
There's my best friend getting sick with a potentially fatal disease, which you know, I don't think that's even really entered my psyche or really settled in within me yet. So I think there's, when the tour comes to its end and I have some time to withdraw, that will all really hit me. And of course, then on a just business level, I turn my focus to the planning and what has to be done and what has to be taken care of.
So, you know, I found myself in hospital again and... not one of my favourite places. And, you know, this is something that, as the doctors tell me, I'm going to be dealing with for the rest of my life. And I have been. And to be honest, I continued the tour. I went through what I had to go through. And then, you know, in between each part that we've done so far, I'm back in hospital.
In most jobs, you know, if you worked in an office and that happened to you, you'd say, right, I'll see you in 6 months. But, as you know, what was it, a month or something like that?
We've always had a good attitude to what we do, you know, and carrying on was very important. But it was obviously Dave's decision, you know.
After that, we had things happening as well. You know, Dave tore his calf muscle, which meant that we had to cancel two shows at the end of the European leg. And then the burst blood vessel in America, which meant we had cancelled two shows on the West Coast of America. You know, and this is, I mean, we've never had anything like this before.
It's amazing, really, that over the 30 years or almost that we've been working together, he hasn't had more injuries or cancellations, because he does put so much into it.
With Andy's dad and then that happening to Dave, and, you know, it just felt like, you know, we were doomed.
It's been a difficult journey, let's say. At times, but you know, it's part of things that happen in life. And if you know, we've been making music together for 30 years, close to, I think, so there's a lot of life that goes on in there, and things happen, you know, there's things that are obviously completely out of your control. You know, you like to think that you're in control of everything, especially when you're on tour, but you know, you're not.
welcome to the Depeche Mode show 2009. So we roll in, there's a platform here for everyone to build on, but everything else that you see, the video screen, the stage set, all the keyboards, all the mixing desks, all the truss, all the speakers, that all fits into 10 trucks, and it takes about 4 or 5 hours to set up. And about 3 hours to break down, which is staggering. You know, I've been doing this a fair while, and I still, you know, still bamboozles me.
Creatures of habit. I can tell you what any of them is going to eat, order for their lunch. I can order Martin's tuna sandwich every single day for him or something of that kind. I mean, literally, I think we're all very much, myself included, creatures of habit.
Oh, rituals. Yeah, oh, this band's all about rituals. There's so many rituals. Essentially, your work's going to happen at 9 o'clock at night, and that's when most people are sort of chilling out in front of the telly. So you want to gear your body clock so that that's when you've got a nice bit of energy going on.
I think that everybody has a, you know, some kind of routine. I mean, I can be flexible a little bit. I'm not, you know, I'm not as strict with my routine as some people.
I have a massage. We have a massage person, which is probably one of the most enjoyable bits pre-gig. And then eat. And then some games of table football, maybe. I'm sort of semi-retired on this tour because I became sort of the best defender in the world.
One second.
So I felt, you know, where do I go from here? But they've got better and better, so I've started playing a bit more. You know.
Just a question of time.
Are you drunk?
I've had a glass of wine. One glass of wine. Yeah.
What?
One and a half, actually.
Uh-oh. Thank God.
Can we play to five, please? Because my back's really killing me.
Yes!
We don't see much of Dave before the show, and obviously he's got the, you know, the hardest job of all, because he has to be, you know, 100% energy for the whole 2 hours. I think Dave has a lot of, you know, he psychs himself up, and but by the time we get to go on stage, he's definitely a different person.
I think he is very different on tour. I think he does kind of like to stay a bit more separate than he does, say, when we're recording. You know, I think that, you know, I mean, we take the same bar football table around with us that we use, you know, in the studio. Dave never plays bar football, you know, on tour, you know, because, I don't know, yeah, maybe it's just not part of his routine, and it's, and he does, you know, maybe it's too much excitement, I don't know.
Every band's different. Some bands... you have five different dressing rooms for the five different people. But Dave, you know, really likes to get his head together and do all his vocal exercises and maybe have a nap, for instance.
Well, years and years ago, that separation happened because we were using different chemicals. But, you know, and they didn't mix well. And I think it sort of, for me... stuck. I was quite comfortable in my isolation, and now it's a different thing. I really do that hour before the show, I like to sort of be with myself, And I have my little routines and rituals. And if I don't have enough time to actually do in a comfortable way, I think I'm going to jinx myself.
I think in some ways it's quite good that we don't see Dave as much as we see each other, the rest of the band sees each other, because you get to see him on stage and then you do get those interactions. And even though a lot of it's similar every night, there's still like a unity there.
I think it's different with Dave because, you know, he's got the whole much more physical aspect to his performance than we have, you know. He's basically running a half marathon, you know, so he's really mentally and physically over at the end of the concert, you know.
I have no idea how he does it. I think it's incredible. Every night it's like you think, is this like the first time he's ever done this show? And it really does feel like that.
I usually start to listen to the drum patterns on the album and then change it if I have to, just to make it work in bigger places. And then I'm usually doing that for, let's say, 3-4 shows, and then I tweak it. This is my new DW drum kit, which was built for me for this tour. As you can see, I'm using a rack system here. All the mics are actually mounted on the rack. There's no mic stands except the overheads and bass drum mics. Yeah, it is different because they were able to build a few things that are new. For example, the piccolo toms here that are really small are tuned up really high. The bass drums are much bigger compared to the ones I used before. The right one's the main kick. And the left one is like an effect kick, tuned up. And I also use bigger cymbals now because I cracked and destroyed too many on the last tour.
We recently started doing this song, One Caress. It was originally done orchestrally, and it was left to me to try and reproduce what 50 people did. I rehearsed it in a day, and I was maybe a little bit like, this is tricky. It's all split up into different sorts of string sounds. I've got basses at the bottom, violas here, and then a few samples at the top. So it's more that, actually. It's like, where's that one? That's over here. It's easy for me to learn a song, you know, just learn the chords and get through it on a piano. With this, it's a bit more structured. There's not so much I can do with it because... But then it's a different animal, you know. I think it's a beautiful song, and I think it's... I think that's the appeal of it.
Singing.
When was the last time you did Dressed in Black then? I mean, before York, this tour.
Isn't it?
Yeah,
we haven't done it that many times on this tour, have we? It's only recently.
Recently, it's a new edition. Right? Mine had this very creative period when he was changing the songs every night, actually, wasn't
he? Who was?
Hmm?
Oh, Peter was.
What?
A song a night it was.
Well,
song.
We have changed.
We started off this leg changing every night, didn't we?
Yeah, we'll change them all. Just not. You don't want to do that before Barcelona, do you? Might as well lock a couple down for that.
You should do The Sun and the Rainfall. You should bring that back. Is there any chance of that?
We never played it, have we? Did we?
We did on the probably. Broken Frame tour, yeah. Yeah. It was the closer. Closer.
Yeah.
Back monument.
The second night onwards.
The most difficult thing is choosing a set list, and that really... is three main members of the band sitting down and making lists of songs that they want to do. And then if, you know, all three of us pick a song, we know it's obviously in the list. If two of us pick a song, it's more than likely in the list. And, you know, then it's like, you know, sort of a little bit of, you know, arguing after that about what the final set list should be.
No, actually, we don't decide at all. And the thing is, we've rehearsed about 200 of our songs and Dave just calls them. Yeah, it was sort of ad-lib, really.
Songs take on different meanings. The longer they live and the longer you live and your life evolves and things happen in your life, for me, the songs represent different things, and quite often all of a sudden something that I had been focusing on in that song that to me for many years was very important is no longer important, and something else emerges.
To be honest, the catalogue of this band is too... It's huge, you know. It's really hard to come up with a good set list. And on the other hand, unfortunately, there's a lot of songs you have to play, which doesn't give you a lot of space for interesting tracks that you would like to do.
You know, there's the obvious Depeche songs that, you know, for me, they're like almost like... It's like the Stones going out and not doing Brown Sugar or or satisfaction, you know, and they get lynched, you know. You know, I'm sure there's plenty of nights when they're like, well, let's not do brown sugar tonight, you know. What are you talking about, Mick? You know that sort of does go on with us too.
I mean, I still enjoy playing those, and you know, the audience reaction's so good. I don't think there's ever a night where I don't enjoy playing the classic songs.
We tend to have a sort of a framework of a set that stays throughout the tour, and then we sort of change or evolve, you could say, things around it by adding songs. And Martin's very good because he's got this acoustic section.
Yeah, we didn't do it for a lot of this tour, but recently we started just practicing things backstage before we went on. And sometimes, you know, we would just spend half an hour learning something and just going on and doing it. And it's quite good at this point in the tour to be spontaneous like that, because it does keep it quite exciting and you know, a bit nerve-wracking.
Start again.
When we first started rehearsing, we had about two or three options of songs. So we, you know, we did the acoustic version of Home and Question of Lust and a couple of other things, and then we started varying it quite a lot more, and then it got to the point where we would just be like on the plane on the way to a gig and just going, do you know that song? Let's try that tonight. So I'm like, got my headphones on and I'm learning it in the plane. Run through it once in the dressing room and then just go on and do it.
Thank you. to anybody on the outside that doesn't do this, it all sounds very glamorous. And we stay in really nice hotels and everything. Great, it's really nice. But, you know, a cheeseburger's a cheeseburger, and you get good ones and you get bad ones. For me, it's all about the performance. Going into battle as it is with Martin there by my side, he put down the booze a while back, and it's really showing now. I think that there's a part of Martin as a performer, to me, is really coming out now.
And I used to get terrible stage fright, you know, probably for all the wrong reasons, you know, like worried that I was going to drop dead on stage. I don't think that's normal stage fright.
Most people just worry about hitting the right note.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't care about that.
Yeah. As long as I just don't drop it.
Not in front of all those people.
In terms of tour fatigue, sure, I think there is tour fatigue. I'm sure Dave's absolutely exhausted. I know he is. I don't blame him running around 2 hours every night.
I mean, I'm knocking 50. I'm actually having to accept that, and because my body is telling me.
It does take a toll. He's been very careful anyway about how he prepares himself for a show and how he rests and all those sort of things. I think he's just put extra emphasis on it, but I think as long as he's fit to perform, then I think he wants to do it.
I wouldn't want to leave it, like, as well. Like, it just sort of peters out into some geriatric old bastard sort of going out there and a couple of little moves, but we know that he's fucked. I really don't want it to become that, because Depeche Mode is too important. Like, if I see this film afterwards, you know, when it comes out and I really look at it and I see that those cracks are really showing, the ones that I really feel, and I hope that you don't all see, I know it's time to hang up the hat.
It's going to be the culmination of 2.5 years' work. So it's going to be very emotional. It's going to take a while to get back to normality, you know, throwing the towels on the floor and your wife's not very happy when you realise there isn't a maid picking it up.
The reason we don't discuss anything is because we really honestly don't know. You know, we will definitely take a break. That will be the, you know, the minimum that we do.
That's all I'm prepared to say.
Yeah, I'm sure there'll be a bit of time off, but it wouldn't surprise me if Martin's back in the studio writing some songs pretty quickly.
It's been really tough on my family, this one, because Jen's been amazing with me getting sick and everything, but, you know, I know that she really worries a lot about how much I do out here and how much I'm sort of giving and not holding a little bit back for myself. But I'm holding a bit back on reserve, you know, so that I can live another day.